These meetings are now into their, well into their second decade. And never, I think, has there been more substantial change, more unanswered questions on the table, more need for fresh, non-knee-jerk thinking. An enormous amount is happening on the surface. And beneath the surface, even more important issues are brewing, ones that will influence development in our areas of concern for years and years to come.
Imagine where we would be were there no arms control agreements and no serious efforts to deal with the proliferation of weapons of mass destruction. I would argue, although imperfect, non-proliferation works. It isn't fun, it isn't easy, it isn't quick, but it works. So we have to increase our efforts rather than giving up hope or fixating on the difficulties.
In the field of disarmament, the record of progress is quite encouraging. Biological and chemical weapons have been outlawed. Reductions in strategic weapons since 1972 have no parallel in history.
Remember how frightened we were, some of you can remember, how frightened we were a generation ago. Recall the predictions of nuclear holocaust and the certitude that 20 to 30 nuclear weapon states would exist by the year 2000. As they say in southern Delaware, it ain't good, but it ain't all that bad. We have made a whole hell of a lot of progress.
Laws regulate relations between individuals and within a state. Use of intimidation and force is a punishable crime. Unfortunately, the community of states has not yet achieved that desirable state of civilization, where relations are governed in conformity with principles of justice and international law.
The non-proliferation treaty regime has worked amazingly well for most of the world. It has not worked for an arc of countries, an arc of proliferation that goes from the Middle East through to Japan. We need to understand that those countries are interrelated with each other. You cannot understand Israel and India and Japan and North Korea and Iraq separately. You need to see them as connected to each other and as an area of the world in which the threat of force remains alive and the threat of the use of nuclear weapons seems very real.
The proliferation of weapons of mass destruction is the number one national security threat facing the United States and its allies. More so than at any other time in the past, the spread of weapons of mass destruction and their means of delivery constitutes a profound and urgent threat at home and abroad.
There are two dangers here. First, the number of countries having nuclear weapons in their possession is growing. Second, there is a threat of unauthorized use or obtaining of those technologies and those materials. After the explosions in South Asia, the nuclear situation is more dangerous than ever. The world may enter a phase where the use of nuclear weapons will be more likely than ever before.
С наглядным примером действий Запада в Югославии.
In the aftermath of the Western actions in Yugoslavia, countries are left to consider that nuclear weapons may be the only guarantee that they won't be next. We can see the first signs of that happening, and we will see that happen if we don't take preventative measures.
If you analyze what the new strategy is going to consist of, first, offenses, second, defenses, third, counter-proliferation, and fourth, armed control. And I think the grading would be just the other way around with the European countries?
There can be no doubt as to who must lead in these matters. No other country comes close to the United States in its ability to offer economic or security incentives in return for forswearing or giving up weapons of mass destruction. But the question is, are we willing to lead? Do we want to lead? And if we do, how must we lead?
Today we spend less than 1% of our annual defense budget on non-proliferation efforts. Let me say that again. The United States spends less than 1% of our defense budget on the first line of defense against the proliferation of weapons of mass destruction and their means of delivery. This is clearly unacceptable. It is far more effective and much cheaper to eliminate threats at their source than attempting to deter or defend against them later. This is not to say that other lines of defense don't have a critical role, but rather at this point in time, there is no better United States investment in combating this threat than the Nonnuclear Cooperative Threat Reduction Program.
How strange is it then that the administration cuts these valuable nonproliferation programs in next year's budget, yet these programs cost money, but the benefits that they deliver in weapons dismantled, in fissile material protected from diversion, in terrorist or rogue states, and in scientists working on socially useful projects, rather than wandering off to Libya or Iraq, I would argue is incalculable. Just think how much we would have to spend if Osama bin Laden gets a weapon of mass destruction.
Real discussion has begun, and President Bush deserves credit for that. He has taken on the responsibility of making pivotal decisions on a non-proliferation strategy, on nuclear force posture, on missile defense, promising to articulate a new national security framework for the United States. As in some areas of the globe, when the ice melts briefly once a year, here in Washington, once in a generation, certain policies long frozen become fluid and can take new shape. If we grasp this passing chance, we can reshape the terrain of our world and make it safer for present and future generations.